Wow. So we didn't realize you're down at Kentucky now, man. You're a defensive quality control assistant with the University of Kentucky.
Yeah, it's going awesome too. Love it.
I'm so glad to hear that.
First time I've ever been in college.
I was going to say you've been around the NFL so much, and which is tremendous. And now you're down at college. You know, we cover the Missouri Tigers kind of on a daily basis here, and so now we got a division rival in you. We got some trash talk a little bit with Missouri finally.
I don't know anything.
Hey, we ran the ball really well in that game, Coach Manusky.
Yeah, you guys did. And you guys can cut like an offensive line can cut like no other.
Well, what's it been like for you? Because I know that you're still coaching. You're at the college level now, but I know that you know the NFL. You know this game, and you look up and you see the Kansas City Chiefs, a team that you played for under Marty Schottenheimer, and here we are playing in our second Super Bowl here. What's it like for you as a former player to kind of see where the Chiefs have gotten here?
Well, I can tell you one thing. It was, you know, I never had a real chance because I was playing in the NFL and then, of course, coaching, and I never had a chance really to cheer for the Chiefs, you know what I'm saying? You know, being in the places I worked, you know, I could never really cheer for them because I think it's a taboo, but, you know, it's just so good to get it, you know, this past year, you know, just being able to cheer for them and watch them and be excited for them because it was a great organization when I was there. And it was great to see what they did last year and then what they're going to do this year.
Talk about when you arrived to Kansas City in 1994. I mean, Joe Montana's there, Marcus Allen, of course, Derek Thomas, the great owner, Lamar Hunt, and our favorite coach of all time, Marty Schottenheimer.
I got released by Minnesota, and then I went back down to Florida, and I remember the Cowboys wanted me in Kansas City. So I went to Kansas City first. They didn't let me out of the place, and it was just a great experience. I was there with Dave Adolph. And with Marty, of course, and Carl. And
was Mike Stock the special teams coach back then?
Yeah. I think maybe on my first year, he wasn't there, but I'm not sure on that. But I say over the time, me and Mike still keep in touch right now. You know, it's great. He's up in Cleveland and stuff. But it's just, it was a great, I mean, I remember my wife going to when we were playing. Our first game was when we were playing San Francisco against, you know, Joe's former team. And, you know, there was jets flying over top. The crowd was going wild. My wife said, this is the best place ever. I said, it's never going to be like this ever, you know, again. But, you know, it was just great to experience that. And, you know, the years that I was there, I mean, just the fellowship and just getting with the guys that we had on the team. I mean, in the coaching staff, it was just, you know, you felt important, you know, which was great being a player.
Well, I think we see such an intangibility about playing with guys like, you know, like Joe Montana or Tom Brady. Now you see him at 43 and just the way that he's been able to shape that team. Did you feel that when you joined the team and the way was there something tangibly different about say the way, you know, a way that the things were presented with Joe Montana. Then the next few years, you got Steve Bono, Elvis Gerback. Was there just something tangible about Joe's presence on that team in 94?
Well, I think big time, you know, from my standpoint, you know, being in the National Football League as long as I have been, it's just, how can I say it right? Is you need a quarterback. That is the main thing. You know, I think anybody that's going to win the Super Bowl, I mean, that's a big component of success for any organization. And with Joe there, you knew you always had a chance, you know, because he was a phenomenal quarterback. And, you know, I mean, wherever I've been, it's vitally important. They're hard to find, you know, in college and stuff, but you know, you got to have a quarterback that can have success. And, you know, in this Super Bowl, there's two guys that have had success that play quarterback, and that's why they're there.
Well, a big quarterback kind of battle and decision down the stretch in 1997 for you guys was Elvis Gerback versus Rich Gannon. Gannon had you guys on a roll down there. And I guess a quarterback doesn't lose his job to injury. A lot of people are saying it was Carl Peterson because Elvis Gerback was making the money. They said Marty just didn't believe a quarterback couldn't lose his job to injury. So there's a lot of guessing going around in Kansas City. Was it Marty? Was it Carl? What do you know, and how did you feel was it Rich Gannon for you, or did you agree with Elvis Gerbach taking over?
Well, you got some information there. You know what the heck you're talking about.
We've talked to both Marty and Carl about this, so.
All right, what'd they say?
Well, you know.
They're both pointing fingers the other way.
Yeah, it was kind of one of those deals.
I think that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to put it both ways.
All right. Was it hard not, you know, you wind up your career in 99. Was it difficult to walk away at that point after a 12-year career and knowing that how good this franchise was here in Kansas City, your entire time here, and to not to have won a Super Bowl? Was that difficult?
Yeah, I knew my career was over. You know, you know it as a player before the coaches know it. Actually, you know, your body just breaks down. You know, over those years of playing so many years, and just going back to that that game. Okay, and that was against Denver, correct? That we played that playoff game. Well, this was the thing. This is what I was telling these guys. I said, I was going to do this. I was one of the captains for special teams. So I was going to go out there and spray my hand, all right, my glove with silicone, and go out there and shake Elway's hand. And they'll have it on his, you know, because that's slick as anything, you know. And I was thinking of doing it, you know. Just my ways of thinking of things. I was like, man, I think I might do this, you know? And then Rich Gannon used to drive me to work sometimes. And he was like, man, I don't know if I would do that, you know? And we were going back and forth. And I said, I'm going to do it. I don't give a shit, you know? So I end up not doing it. And then during the game, it was another thing. It was the first, second quarter, whatever quarter it was. But like Brian Habib, Zimmerman, Loudermilk, all those guys had silicone all over their jerseys, and they had to wipe them down. And then that's when they banned silicone. But I remember Alex Gill probably spraying down the players and stuff. But I should have put it on my hand and shaked Elway's hand, and it just got them all slippery and fumbling the ball. But I didn't. That was bad.
So are we blaming you for that 97 loss?
Yeah, you can blame me.
We wish you would have done it. You should have done it.
Yeah, I should have done it. Right. It would have paid me a little bit more extra money, but you know, it is what it is.
Well, you also played defense. You weren't just a special teamer. You got some games started on the defensive side of the football. Talk to us about Gunther Cunningham. We recently lost him, the great head coach, defensive coordinator in the NFL, and just a great man. Talk to us about Gunther, who he was as a coach and as a man.
Well, I tell you, he did a great job of just educating everybody, you know, from the corners to the safeties to the linebackers, which was basically his room, you know, and just going through, you know, I felt so bad when he passed away. It's like, I'm getting older and all these people are dying. And I'm like, hey, you know, hopefully I can take care of myself. But just overall, Gunther was just a very good coach, you know, and a good person, you know, and the best thing about him was he would get his highs and lows, but he was always direct with you. You know, and you knew where you stood with him. And as a player in the National Football back in that time was, you know, you just wanted the truth. They just tell me the truth. Okay. You know, you're a backup player. That's what he told me. Okay. Well, I'm going to try to excel on special teams and do what I have to do there. And just overall, it was just you know, he would banter with you a little bit here and there. And it was just a great situation for the whole team to learn from him. And the knowledge he had was really, it was awesome.
Well, you're a true testament to, in my opinion, hard work, determination, all the things that you have, because you come in undrafted into the league out of Colgate, Greg. You have a 12-year NFL career. What was that like for you when you come into the league? A lot of guys come in, they're draft picks. They know they're going to make a roster. For you, it was uncertainty out of the gate, man, and yet you were able to parlay that into a 12-year career. How were you able to do that?
A lot of hard work. And I'm trying to tell the kids here in Kentucky, you know, it's what you put it. If you're going to work for a company, come out of college and you say, okay, I'm going to work for Microsoft. Well, you better know something about computers. All right. You're going to work for any giant corporation. You better know something about the business. And it's the same way here with these college players. You got to know football. If you want to go to the next level and play, you got to learn it and you got to know it inside and out. And I try to tell everybody it's you got to work harder than anybody else, because I knew they were going to draft somebody in the third round, fourth round. And, you know, you got to beat that guy out, you know. And what I try to do is every day try to get better, watch what was going on in the field when I wasn't playing. You know, I was on the sidelines and, you know, whatever the call was, it was always going through my head. And then, you know, basically I learned football from Monty Kiffin and Tony Dungy. I mean, those two individuals taught me the game of football and where all the pieces fit. And when I was in Minnesota, and then, you know, just parlayed that into doing the same thing in Kansas City. It was a backup player. I knew where I was, and I knew I was, my hay was playing special teams, you know, and trying to make plays in the special teams unit. But, you know, overall, you know, it was just a good career. But, you know, once that 12th year came around, I knew it was over. My body was just broken down, and I didn't have any juice like I used to have.
Well, you've moved on into the second career as a coach, and just tell us what Marty means to you in that sense, because he gave you your first break as a coach in the league in 2001 as a linebackers coach for Washington, and then that same role with the Chargers when he moved over there the next year.
Yeah, I mean, just a great coach. I mean, he broke it down so well, you know, like on Mondays or Tuesdays when we were in there on a Wednesday or whatever it was, he gave you a game plan, which was great. He said, okay, this is what we got to do from a defensive standpoint. This is what we got to do special teams wise. And then what we have to do offensively. And the best thing is he presented to all the players and he told you, this is how we're going to win the game. Either, you know, we got to get a couple interceptions or fumble recoveries, or we got to get a possession on special teams. It could be, he was always talking about field position and where the ball was and turnovers. And he gave it to you on them, you know, on those Tuesdays or Wednesdays. And he said, here's the plan. And then you played the game. And if you had success, nobody really gave a shit what the plan was. All right. But the best thing was when he came back the next week, he says, I told you this was the plan, you know, or, you know, we gave up too many touchdowns, or the offense turned the ball over, or whatever it might have been. You know, he gave you a script to say, this is what we need to do. And as a player, you felt, all right, he gave us the plan on Monday or Tuesday. You know, we didn't execute that plan when it came on Sunday. And I think he had a lot of success with that plan going through his whole career. And it was just great to, you know, especially for me as a former player with him, and then all of a sudden being a coach with him. I mean, it was Marty ball now. I remember that first time when we were in Washington and we were up in Carlisle, he would watch the offense. And then after that, he would come over to the defense. He was a night guy. So at night, he would just watch film all the time. So it was like 12:30 at night. Okay. And then he came in and we started the meeting. I was like, what? Are you kidding me? I got to go to bed, bro. I'm tired. And then we started watching one-on-ones with the DBs. I'm a linebacker coach. I don't need to know that shit.
And we heard just that Daryl Green didn't take kindly to him, like coming over and talking about the details, these tiny details of his game. He's like, man, I'm an all pro. I've been at this forever. What are you doing, Marty?
Well, it was amazing. The time I was like, oh my God, this is forever. I thought I was literally going to die for not getting any sleep, but you know, afterwards you kind of calmed down a little bit, but it was just, I mean, the time that he spent offensively and defensively, it was important to him every day that he was at work, you know. And then even after games and stuff, when I was down, especially coaching with him, I mean, he'd look at me and go, you got to move on, bro. you got to move forward. You're going to have some losses in the National Football League, you know. And I was like, okay. So I kind of took that at heart. And then my career after being away from Marty, you know, it took its own little brand of, you know, trying to do exactly what he did. And how he was so meticulous, though. I remember handing out sheets of paper with like wording that was wrong, and he'd circle it. And I was like, okay, the is not spelled. He goes, hey, that's grammar. You got to make sure that's spelled right. And I was like, oh, what? Are you kidding me? It's the word the. Who cares how is it spelled? You know, the players know. But it was amazing how meticulous he was on you game planning somebody and going through that, even the right words and the spelling and this, that, or you missed this guy's alignment or something. I was like, holy crime. And he said, I should have never gave him the sheets, but it helped me as a player or as a coach.
Oh, Greg, you've been at a high level coaching now for 20 years. You've been the defensive coordinator of four different NFL teams. Talk about how hard it is today, because we're seeing record numbers. You see what Patrick Mahomes is doing and so many other quarterbacks. Aaron Rodgers had another unbelievable year. Tom Brady's at 43 doing this. And how much of that is helped by the fact that the roles are slanted towards the offense? Corners can't touch a receiver past 5 yards. We have all these personal fouls and leading with the helmet and things that protect the offense. How difficult is it to coach defense in this day and age?
I should have played offense. That's what I should have did. So you're just thinking about it. In the NFL, they don't want to see 9-6 games. They want to see 42-34, you know what I'm saying? Which is, you want to see scores. I mean, that's what you want to see. And protecting the quarterback, I'm all for it. Because if you have a stud and you have a guy, you'll have success. If you lose that guy, you're not going to be probably in the playoffs, you know? But overall, I tell my wife sometimes, I said it was like you took two final exams during college, all right, after the game. That's what it felt like. Mentally, you're just so drained as a coordinator that it's hard, you know, trying to take away the fly sweeps or the ghost motions or the empties and the 4x1s. And, you know, it's hard, you know. And I think during the year, I mean, teams wear down, of course, because there's a lot of games in the National Football League. And it really does, you know, if you could protect the players a little bit more from a standpoint of from a rosters coaching them, because you only got so many guys on the roster, you know, and when they get hurt or a main guy gets hurt, I mean, it affects everybody because you got to change your calls during those times, you know, that somebody does get injured or hurt during the game. And then for, you know, if they get hurt early on, then it doesn't help you much as a coordinator.
Yeah, absolutely. And Greg, you mentioned Marty Ball a little earlier, and that kind of brought something up for me that I wanted to ask you about. Do you believe that Marty Ball was the reason that you guys didn't succeed? Like the game plan, playing not to lose, playing it safe, playing it close to the vest was the reason you guys didn't win more in the playoffs, the 95 game, Lynn Elliott and Steve Bono, interceptions, missed field goals, 97 Elvis Gerbach didn't execute down the stretch. And then with the Chargers, you have Marlon McCree picking off Tom Brady, then fumbling it right back to him, Nate Kading missing a kick. Was it Marty Ball or was it just not executing? Just if Marty didn't have bad luck, he'd have no luck. A lot of people say.
And you know, the Marlon McCree thing that killed me. I mean, that killed a lot of people, but you know, overall, I think, you know, he had success during the year. You know, even when we were in Washington, the first year that I was there coaching with him, it was like, hey man, anybody can win 8 games. And I was like, what? You know, anybody could do that. I was like, oh, okay, this is great. You know, but you know, going into it, I think the same game plan, I think you're playing better defenses. You're playing better offense when you're in the playoffs. Right. And I think you got to take some chances here and there. And that's just me talking. Now I was a player and of course a coach, but you know, I think he kind of kept it close to the vest, you know, cause that Marty Ball was running the ball and doing it, I think gives you success throughout the year. But I think when you're playing those better defenses and better offenses, you got to change it up a little bit more, you know, and I think maybe that could have been the key to maybe having success or making a field goal or whatever it might've been, yeah. You know, but you know, he did a great job. And the thing that I think Marty, just over the years that I've known him and stuff, it was just, I was fortunate as a player to play for him. And I was fortunate as a coach to coach for him, because he was one of the better ones in the league. And, you know, I see him as more of a father figure to me. You know, he did a lot for me and my family, and I couldn't ask for anything more.
Well, that's absolutely wonderful, Greg. We can't thank you enough for being on with us today. Before we cut you loose, we got to hit you with our 4th and goal. 4 quick questions. You give us whatever comes to mind, man, and then we'll get you out of here. Sound good?
All right.
All right. Biggest transition from coaching in the NFL to now college at the University of Kentucky? What's the biggest transition for you?
Formations. Different formations, a lot into the boundary, FSL formation into the sideline. That is the biggest thing.
Yeah, those hashes, man, they'll get you.
All these guys unbalanced and everybody into the boundary, it'll mess you up a little bit.
Second of goal here. If this is the last go around for Drew Brees, just tell us more about the player and man really quick that you saw up close during your time with the Chargers.
True blue, you know, I think, you know, he was a guy that bring his lunchbox to work every day and try to get better every day. As players here, I try to, you know, try to tell them every day you got to get better because somebody else is out there trying to take your job or do whatever you have to do. And that's one thing I think about Breezy, you know, the years that he was, he spent in San Diego and then, you know, with New Orleans, just true blue.
Speaking of someone that's true blue, just give us in the 1 year that you knew Coach John Schlarman, talk about him. What was he like? We lost him this year and November 12th. You've got to be around him for this year. What are some phrases that you'd use to describe him?
I mean, he was just a man that loved coaching, loved his family, loved the Lord, did everything the right way, you know, and I came at the end of his life and, you know, and it was only here for a year, but I could tell you one thing, the guy worked every day. And it was amazing even seeing him on the couch down in the locker room, you know, taking a little break here and there, you know, and still going through the struggles that he had. And then just him working every day, you know, what at a craft that he loved to play the game and loved his the guys that he was working with, you know, it was just, it was awesome. It really was. I you know, I feel so bad for what happened. And, but I can tell you one thing, if you say his name gives me goosebumps because I know the man that he was, and he was a great one.
Well said, Greg. And here's our last one, fourth and goal. We got to punch it in. We've talked about him a lot during this interview. Should Marty Schottenheimer be in the Hall of Fame?
Yeah, no doubt. I mean, he had consistent wins across the board from year to year. Didn't have the success that he wanted in the playoffs. The Marlon McCree, damn it. I could still see that every day, yes, you know. And too. I think that, well, that was just, I hated it. But it is what it is. But, yes, he should be in the Hall of Fame.
Well, we got to add a fifth down. You know, Missouri and Colorado back in 1990, there was a fifth down that allowed Colorado to beat Missouri. It's something that, as my dad talks about to this day, he hasn't moved on with his life. So, fifth down for you. We got to add one more because we got Super Bowl 55 is, you know, 10 days away or so. Who wins? Chiefs versus Buccaneers. And how many Super Bowls does Patrick Mahomes wind up with in his career?
I think he's going to end up with five. Okay. He's going to end up with five. And I got to go with the Chiefs.
All right.
Guaranteed.
There you have
it. Well done.
Coach, it has been such an honor. Best of luck down in Kentucky. We'll have to catch up. We go to Kentucky. Missouri does this year. So we will be in Lexington next year. Hopefully things are kind of more back to normal. And we will come down and we'll let you pick out your favorite steak place, man. We'll take you out for some steak dinner down in Lexington. I know there's some good spots down there, man.
Oh, they're great ones. Looking right, forward man. To it.
You bet. Congratulations right, on care, the game, Kentucky, and best of luck going forward, man.
It was an absolute honor. Thank you.
You got it, bro. Bye.
Bye.